Yeah, can we turn it down?
Or just this. Not this box.
And action.
Once he turns. I'd received a Guggenheim Foundation grant and traveled back to Suriname to make a film. Taken as a whole, the film... I still need lights to read. Taken as a whole, the film was going to be about syncretism, about how the legacy of slavery in Suriname had made it impossible to locate an original or traditional Saramaccan culture in the present. The film would be about time organized vertically, about how not knowing and the phenomenological experience of bodies could make cinema into a site of post-colonial resistance. An essential piece of this film would take place during the Saramaccan transpossession funeral ceremony called Adjo, a ceremony that I'd attended a number of times and even danced once or twice in while I was living in Bendeconde. Once I got to Suriname, I started asking around to see when, where Adjo would take place. The answer was in 3 weeks, in Malobi, a Saramaccan village on the upper Suriname River that I'd never visited. I traveled by motor canoe to Malobi with Benjin, Muni, Edu, Abini, Gangas, Sene, and two other Saramaccans from Bendeconde. Chris, my Irish study cam operator, and an American sound recordist. The Saramaccans were excited to go because Malobi throws big parties. They call it the Paramaribo of the jungle. I brought Chris because he was willing to work for free and because he lives in Amsterdam. And so initially I thought that he was Dutch, that it would be useful to have somebody with some kind of relationship to that place, even a colonial one. In the end, it was better that he wasn't Dutch. The Surinamese hate the Dutch. We arrived at Malobi just as the sun was setting on the river, carrying 5 or 6 bottles of 90% Palom rum and 3 cases of soft drinks. Benjamin had advised me on how much to bring, and I hoped it was enough. This was my payment to the village, offered to the village government after a long formal conversation with the captain and 2 sub-captains of Malobi. After the offering was made, we set up hammocks and mosquito nets in the huts that we were sleeping in, then began wandering around the village as the generators roared and Karawina music started playing. Chris went to bed early. I tried to be as visible as possible, to speak and dance and drink and eat with as many people as I could before going to sleep at 4 in the morning. The village kept dancing while I slept. I woke up at 8 a.m. to the sound of Chris organizing his gear, to the echo of drums from the village center. I loaded the camera with a fresh 400 magazine of 50 daylight 16mm film, talked to Chris a bit about what to expect and how we would film the ceremony. I expected the Adjo to be crazy, hoped it would be at least. I expected there to be barrel throwing and tall men jumping into the fire. Benjamin warned us a few times that we should be careful lest the Winti spirits threw barrels directly at the camera. I spent the next 36 minutes walking the path from the hut to the center, watching the timer function on my watch to see how long 10 minutes was and what would happen during the time that we'd be filming. At 10 a.m., Benjamin and the others came to the hut and pulled a big garbage bag out from somewhere. They opened it up, pouring out an array of rubber masks and granny dresses, gloves, and rubber boots. I'd asked Benjamin to bring the orange suit with him, was excited to see a rubber clown mask with a shock of orange hair, and asked him to wear it. Gangasini took the old white man mask, the Edu witch. He asked me for something to stuff his bra with. I gave him 2 pairs of underwear. They all put their costumes on, and once we heard the Adjo drum sounding, I told them how the filming would go. Really, just how it would begin, as I didn't have any plans beyond once they reached the center and the dancing started in full. I told them to stay in the hut, and Chris started filming. I marked the beginning of the reel with the small clapper. Benjamin emerged from the darkness, and the drag witch followed. We moved with them to the center, Benjamin slowly becoming his elder clown character, and kids running away as we approached. I stayed close to Chris, telling him to keep Benjamin, the orange clown, in the frame at all times, to keep the perimeter away and stay out of the middle. This was a funeral, and we were not the most important event. The drums grew louder and faster as the dancers entered the circle, but then suddenly one of the drummers saw the camera and threw up his arms, stopped playing. Toby moved towards him to appease him. Luckily, the captain from the previous night was sitting next to him and calmed down. As this was happening, the old clown moved out of the circle and into the empty village, waving to a devil sitting down to rest. I could hear the drums picking up again and told him to stand. He moved back towards the center and met the drag witch, then continued into the circle where the dance began in full. My sound recordist, Chris, and I walked behind him, moved around the perimeter, heard the screams of delight as the drag witch pulled out a giant dildo, applied a condom to it, and one of the Basikanumi began fellating him. The drag witch sprung up off the ground and began simulating sex as the audience cheered and a man in blue jeans stepped out to record the act on a cell phone. The film ran out just as the action reached its peak, and Chris, exhausted, turned to me to take the Steadicam as we left the circle and returned to the hut. The filming had taken 10 minutes, the length of one 400-foot roll of film. While this shot was part of a larger film, I wanted to see how the same piece of footage could lead multiple lives, and I released it on its own under the title Trip 6 Malobi.
Hey, Bang Basma, do you know any good jokes?
I do.
Tell me one.
Two beautiful statues were in a park facing each other across the grass. One of a young girl and the other of a young man. Looking towards each other like young lovers, these statues gave so much pleasure to people visiting the park that God looked down and decided to reward them with life for 30 minutes. On a Sunday when the park was closed to the public, immediately when they came to life, they ran together into the bushes and could be heard giggling and cooing with pleasure, and the bushes were shaking. After 15 minutes, they came out and realized that they still had 15 more minutes to live. "What shall we do now, then?" said the boy statue. "Let's do the same thing again," she replied. "Okay," said the boy statue, "but this time you hold the pigeons down while I shit on them."
Okay. Now that that's out of the way, should we continue with this talk?
Yes, and even though we've written the text and are reading it, let's make it seem as though it were a conversation.
Okay, so I'll play me and you can be you.
Or vice versa?
Either way, we'll become subjects through representation.
And does representation exist without an audience?
In 2014, I was commissioned by the London Palestine Film Foundation to create a work that engaged the Palestinian revolutionary period by specifically responding to a militant film by a living filmmaker. I decided to make a work based on Kasim Hawal's Our Small Houses, a 1974 black and white short film that addresses, in Marxist poetics, both Palestinians and Israelis as people who had suffered and were destined to continue suffering. "Kill or be killed," the film states. The moment of this film 40 years ago is an instance when the two populations' suffering was somehow still in close proximity to one another. I saw this moment as one that had been buried in the past, a moment that had died along with any hope for a Palestinian homeland or freedom or justice. I wanted to reproduce the experience of dragging that past out from its grave and confronting it with the present. The film, titled O Persecuted, is a product of that. So the process of making this work involved painting over Hoal's film, Our Small Houses, filmed in reverse at 2.5 times the speed using 16mm film. When reversed, the black paint slowly appears to be lifted off the wall to reveal the film. This was paired with a manipulated soundtrack from the film recorded backwards that mimicked a pulling of the soundtrack from under the earth. Initially, the film was based only on this act of uncovering, but as soon as I made the first cut, there was something sort of placid and banal about this act alone, something limited to a past, and my feeling about conjuring this history in the present was anything but passive. I was asked to engage with this material and saw it as an opportunity to speak to the current political climate, to recreate violence without violent imagery. Increasingly, there's been a lot of talk about the conflict, about self-determination for Palestinians, injustice, and war crimes. There's heavy condemnation of what Israel has done, is doing, will continue to do, and yet very little actually changes. How much time has passed since these films were made, and how much worse is the situation? Hawala's film is unique in that it alludes to addressing both Palestinians and Israelis as persecuted people who are thrown together into a merciless battle. The past represented in the film is, first of all, one entity and not the fractured set of territories of today. Looking back on this moment is like moving in slow motion while the Israeli future is billowing forward without looking back. This is how the decision to bring the material of Israeli girls partying on the beach came about. These two realities are so inextricably intertwined, but so totally disconnected from one another. Another important aspect for me was to force women and women's bodies into this narrative, as women's rights are second to the conflict, thereby reinforcing continued oppression and or exploitation within each society. One of the biggest obstacles for me of spending time in the Middle East has been the dire situation of women's rights. Ooh. So sad. Anyway, looking back at films of the revolutionary period in Palestine, it is painfully clear that women had more rights and more importance in the struggle than they do today. Conflating this moment in history with the westernized spring break type footage from Israel is to say that even though the other side seems to be having a better time, the women there are objectified and degraded. On one side, women's rights are suppressed because of the overall humanitarian crisis, while on the other, women's bodies are used to promote a seductive image of the country that is completely contradictory to the supposed security threats that affords Israel the green light to engage in major warfare whenever it wants. Conflating this with the Orientalist belly dancer footage as the bridge between the two and the ghost that lingers beneath the surface is to show the disparity between the reality of this landscape and how much work there is to be done that has nothing to do with nationalism and statehood. It's meant to force us to return to this idea in Hawal's film, that both people are persecuted and faced with the same fate, to kill or be killed, and to think about this question today as history moves in slow motion and the future is speeding towards us.
Do you know any good jokes?
Yeah, I do.
Tell me one.
What's the best thing about fucking 23-year-olds?
What?
There's 20 of them.
Okay, now that that's out of the way, should we continue with this talk?
Yes, and even though we have a written text, let's make it seem as though it were a conversation.
Okay, so I'll play me and you can be you.
Or vice versa.
Either way, we'll become subjects to representation.
Does representation exist without an audience?
That was a joke, and we took pleasure in it.
Yours was better. I am here, and there is nothing to say.
If among you are those who wish to get somewhere, let them leave at any moment.
What we require is silence.
But what silence requires is that I go on talking.
Give anyone thought a push, it falls down easily.
But the pusher and the pushed produce that entertainment called a discussion.
Should we have one later?
You guys get to decide. You are there and you say nothing.
If either one of us wants to get somewhere, then we should leave at any moment.
What you require is silence.
But what silence requires is that you go on talking.
Give anyone thought a push, and it falls down easily.
But the pusher and the pushed produce that entertainment called a discussion.
Will you be having one later?
So that was from John Cage in his lecture on Nothing, where the title of this performance lecture comes from.
Can I ask everybody now in the audience, you should have had a piece of paper on your chair to draw a horse.
And
it doesn't matter if you know how to draw or not. Just draw it.
What are you doing about this?
Yeah, something's going on.
Huh?
Once it settles again. If anyone needs a pen also, I think there are extra pens floating around somewhere.
And this is a serious request, but it's not an urgent request.
I'm here and I have a story to tell.
I have a story to tell, but I'm not really much of a storyteller, so please don't follow my words too closely.
Listen closely as you move with me in parallel. Draw yourself an image to distract yourself from mine, and then show me this image later.
What my story requires is attention to detail. Details that I don't necessarily own, so if during this talk your mind wanders, that is a good thing.
Wandering is a good practice.
Wandering is a way to get lost. It is a means to escape yourself and mine.
Think now of a question as you're drawing, and prepare yourself to ask it later.
Should I answer the question now or later?
Later is already now, and we're continuing to move forward.
I'm returning to this story, to this moment now.
To an eternal return.
Beginning is always the hardest part, second only to ending, and since I can't end before I begin, I should begin.
In the beginning?
Was that a joke?
I guess it wasn't very funny.
The best jokes are actually the ones that hurt a bit, like this one. What is the best thing about fucking 23-year-olds?
What?
There are 20 of them.
That was a joke you told before, but it wasn't appropriate.
Well, I flew here from Los Angeles, and my sense of what is appropriate may not have flown with me.
It was a long flight, delayed by 5 hours, and while I was waiting, I could not wait for it to be later.
Coincidentally, later is now again. Do you have an image to share with me yet?
Not now, later.
Okay. I'm here, and I'm telling a story.
This is the part where the story begins.
A story needs a character, though. At the very least, it needs a character.
Where will we find a character?
What's going on? I just realized that I've been busy drawing my own image. And so I propose to stop and instead continue speaking, to continue talking in the hopes that a character will form out of the figures gathered in front of you.
You mean in the figures gathered in front of you?
Well, one or the other.
Both.
Both of the figures gathered in front of you have a story to tell. Both of them have a character to share.
In the case of one, the character is well developed, as it is younger and has less time.
In the case of the other, the character is well developed as it is older and has less experience.
Experience is a function of time.
Time flies and us with it.
The world rotates.
The world rotates, the world becomes landscape through presence.
When I'm in the woods, or if I'm in the desert, when I'm standing on a cliff at the edge of the ocean, I look out at the world and my presence names it landscape.
At this moment, the world is built in relation to me. It springs forth as a vista that I own and occupy.
When I recede, the world returns to itself, becomes nature again, as if I am not also nature, am not also landscape.
I make an image of the world, fixing it in time.
I make a representation, and I call it subject, pointing elsewhere, always beyond me.
When I release the shutter, the world returns to itself. The subject becomes nature again, as if I am not also nature, but also subject.
I am a subject, and I have a story to tell.
Story depends on narrator, but narrator depends on author, and both have everything to do with character.
Who speaks, and who gets to speak?
Who am I to... Who am I when I speak, and who are you when you listen? Is an unreliable narrator better than none at all?
So many questions.
Wish we had answers.
Later on, I suspect we will.
Well, it's later again, and we're still more or less where we started.
Two characters in search of an author, two authors in search of a narrator, two narrators in search of a story.
An audience patiently waiting, asked to draw a horse in parallel.
That reminds me, can you guys all draw a horse?
That's why we already drew a horse. Mm-hmm. Everybody, please hold your horse up in the air so that we can see it. Seriously. Everybody, come on.
And maybe the lights can come up.
Yeah,
so we
bring the lights
up
so you can see the horses. If you didn't draw a horse, now's your chance. Quick horses. Could we get the lights up a little bit?
Just the lights go up just
so
a tiny bit.
What's going on. Horses in the air higher.
Or not, stay in the dark. I don't want to see your fucking horse.
Basma?
How come everyone's drawn their horse sideways?
I mean, it's like they haven't drawn a horse. They've drawn a drawing of a horse.
Or an idea of what a horse looks like. Not a horse.
Huh. Well, we didn't get the lights, and we don't have an image. But let's return to the story, which has already begun.
We are now in the latter half of the second part, roughly... 16 minutes in, with
24
minutes remaining.
There are 23 minutes remaining, and we are nearing the end of the latter half of the second part.
Exploitation.
The third part is called Exploitation.
Is a pleasure.
Is a pleasure. So, I've lived in the USA for most of my life.
I have been to Palestine.
I have suffered.
I am forbidden to visit Tel Aviv.
I have been denied from traveling to the West Bank and Jerusalem.
My family suffered in Gaza and escaped the occupation after the war in 2009.
I make work about Palestine because of my proximity to it as a subject.
I point my camera at the camps and I use images of suffering.
I have lived in the USA for most of my life.
I spent 2 years in Suriname working on water and sanitation projects.
I learned Saramaccan and Saranantongo and formed a 17-year relationship with a Maroon family.
I make work about Saramaccans because of my proximity to them as subjects.
I point my camera at their bodies and use images of their thatched villages.
I feel more comfortable speaking to other Palestinians about the occupation.
I feel more at ease when I know that a journalist covering an event in the territory is a Palestinian.
I know that in the work that I make, I have ethics.
How do you know that you have ethics in what you do?
I understand that filmmaking is exploitation.
I understand that to represent is to misrepresent.
And I understand that power is unequal and present in all exchanges.
I understand that I am a subject and my subject is representation.
So let's return to the drawing of the horse. And now it becomes very important that the projector works.
we can't show
those of you who know how to operate the system should please help us.
Yeah, I know. Try it again.
Yeah.
Do you want to stall?
No, we lost the connection.
What do you think? This is the unscripted part of the lecture.
Me too, me too.
I have an idea.
Do you want it to be mirrored or do you want it to be the same?
Yeah.
I think it's not connected at all. It's
no.
No, it's not. It's definitely not.
Yeah.
My desktop isn't showing up on it.
Should we have them draw another horse?
What do we do with that?
Huh?
What do we do with that?
Should we play that song again? Yeah. Where is it?
It's in VLC.
We're just going to play some intermission music for you guys.
Cube and easy motherfucking E. Order. Ice Cube, take the motherfucking stand. Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help your black ass?
You goddamn right.
Won't you tell everybody what the fuck you gotta say?
Police coming straight from the underground. Young nigga got it bad cause I'm brown. Not the other color, so police think they have the authority to kill a minority. Fuck that shit cause I ain't the one. Little punk motherfucker with a badge and a gun to be beat on and thrown in jail. We can go toe to toe in the middle of a cell. Fucking with me cause I'm a teenager with a little bit of gold and a pager. Searching my car, looking for the product. Taking every nigga is selling narcotics. Rather see me in the pen than me and Lorenzo rolling in the Benzo. Be the police out of shape, and when I finish, bring the yellow tape to take off the scene of the slaughter. Still can smell my bread and water. I don't know if they facts or what. Search a nigga down and grabbing his nuts. And on the other hand, without a gun, it can't get none. But don't let it be a black and a white one, cause they'll slam you down to the street top. Black police showing out for the white cop. Ice Cube will swarm on any
motherfucker in the full uniform. Just cause I'm from the CPT, the police are afraid of me, huh? A young nigga on the warpath, and when I finish, it's gonna be a bloodbath of cops dying in LA. Yo, Dre, I got something to say.
Police watch me. Police watch me. Police watch me. Police is that
one. Shit, you know what the fuck you put me on for? Cause I feel like it. Just sit your ass on the curb and shut the fuck up.
Man, fuck this shit.
I ain't smart ass, I'm taking your black ass to jail.
MC Ren, will you please give your testimony to the jury about this fucked up incident?
Fuck police, and Ren said it with authority. Because the niggas on the street is a majority of gang. It's with whoever I'm stepping. And a motherfucking weapon is kept in a stash spot for the so-called law. Wishing Ren was a nigga that they never saw. Lights start flashing behind me, but they're scared of a nigga, so they mace me to blind me. But that shit don't work, I just laugh. Because it gives them a hint not to step in my path. Police, I'm saying fuck you, punk. Read my rights and shit, it's all junk. Running out of silly clock, so you stand with a fake ass badge and a gun in your hand. Take off the gun so you can see what's up. But go at it, punk, and I'ma fuck you up. Make you think I'ma kick your ass. But drop the gat, the Ren's gonna blast. I'm sneaky as fuck when it comes to crime. But I'ma smoke them now and not next time. Smoke any motherfucker that sweats me. Any asshole that threatens me. I'm a sniper with a hell of a scope. Taking out a cop or two that can't cope with me. The motherfucking villain that's mad. The potential to get bad as fuck. So I'ma turn it around. Put in my clip, yo, and this is the sound. Yeah, something like that, but it all depends on the size of the gap. Taking out the police will make my day, but a nigga like Ren don't give a fuck to say. Police watch me. Police watch me. Police watch me. Police watch me.
Yeah, man, what you need?
Police, up and out. We have a warrant for EZ's arrest.
Damn, put your hands behind my seal.
What the fuck can I have? What are you on?
Just shut the fuck up and get your motherfucking ass on the floor.
Once you step up to the stand and tell the jury how you feel about this bullshit.
I'm tired of a motherfucking jacket. Sweat my gang while I'm chilling in the shack and shining the light in my face and for what? Maybe it's because I kick so much butt I get gas. Or maybe because I blast on a stupid ass nigga when I'm playing with the trigger of an Uzi or an AK. Cause the police always got something stupid to say. They put out my picture with silence. Cause my identity by itself causes violence or even with the criminal behavior. Yeah, I'm a gangster, but still I got flavor. Without a gun in the badge, what do you got? A sucker in a uniform waiting to get shot by me or another nigga. And with a gun, it don't matter if he's smaller or bigger. And as y'all know, these here the rule. Whenever I'm rolling, keep looking in the mirror. And it's on cue, yo, so I can hear a dumb motherfucker with the gun. And if I'm rolling up the 8, he'll be the one that I take out and then get away. While I'm driving off laughing, this is what I'll say.
Fuck police, watch me. Fuck police, watch me. Fuck police, watch me. Fuck police, watch me.
The jury has found you guilty of being a redneck, white bread, chicken shit motherfucker.
Hey, that's a lie! That's a goddamn lie!
Get him out of here!
I want justice!
Get him the fuck out of my face!
I want justice!
Out right now!
Fuck you, you black motherfucker!
Fuck the police!
Thanks for everybody's patience. It will come together at some point.
It'll be so remarkable when it happens. If you guys want to draw another horse to make good on that bad horse that you drew the first time, we saw your horses from up here.
Yeah, put Aram.
What else we got?
Aram. It's all like that.
Where is it? Yeah. We'll get it for you.
Something really different, though, this time. Oh.
Yeah, just wiggle it up here.
Valverde.
Huh?
Valverde. Valverde. Lights down in front. So pretend like there wasn't any time between the last thing we said and this thing. Oh yeah, so what we're going to do, we're going to show them the horses. Yeah? Go back to the horse drawing? Yeah, drawing.
Let's go back to the horse drawing just for a minute. You ready for the horse drawing?
And if we can have the spotlights off.
Sure. Here's a mouse. How can we get these? No, yes.
Could you guys turn off the lights in the front, please?
Okay.
Thank you. Just in the front, these spotlights. Are you ready? Spotlights, beautiful. Side lights, maybe the side lights as well. No, it's cool. We'll go with this. Thank you.
الصديق المضطهد، غدا ستلبس البدلة العسكرية، عاملا وتلبس البدلة، مزارعا وتلبس البدلة، تلميذا وتلبس البدلة، فنانا وتلبس البدلة، ويلعون البندقية على كتفك شئت أم أبيت، ويلقون بك على مقعد قيادة الطائرة، ويزجون بك في أتون الحرب. غدا أما أن تقتل أو تموت، بين اختيارين في كماشة الموت، موتان أسود وأزرق، أزرق وأسود، تموت أو تقتل، تقتل أو تموت، تقتل، تموت، تموت، تقتل.
Thank you. stacks are up.
If we could get the lights again. Woo. So, first of all, thank you for your patience. Secondly, here we are now at the beginning of the third unit of the fourth large part of this talk.
More and more I have the feeling that we are getting nowhere.
Slowly, as the talk goes on, we're getting nowhere, and that is a pleasure.
It is not irritating to be where one is.
It is only irritating to think that one would like to be somewhere else.
Here we are now a little bit after the beginning of the third unit of the fourth large part of this talk.
More and more, I have the feeling that we have the feeling that I am getting nowhere.
Slowly as the talk goes on, slowly we have the feeling we are getting nowhere.
That is a pleasure which will continue.
If we are irritated, it is not a pleasure.
Nothing is not a pleasure if one is irritated, but suddenly it is a pleasure, and then more and more it is not irritating. And then more and more, and slowly.
Originally we were nowhere, and now again we are having the pleasure of being slowly nowhere.
If anybody is sleepy, let him go to sleep.
Shall we have a discussion?
I don't think there's time for a
discussion. I don't think there's time for a discussion. But if anybody would like one, let him raise his hand, him yeah. or her. That's you.
Yeah, you.
Yeah. Then thank you.
Thanks.